Hello friends, I hope you all are doing well. So in today's lecture, I will discuss about the occipito-posterior position under the heading mal position. So this is basically an abnormal position. So its definition in vertex presentation. The occiput placed posteriorly over the sacroiliac joint or directly over the sacrum. So this position is known as occipito-posterior position. Under occipito-posterior, there is three terms. So first one is, so here is a sacrum. So this is a symphysis pubis. So this is a head of the fetus. So this is a occiput. And here is a sinciput. That is the mid of the forehead. So this is sacroiliac joint, where the sacrum and the ilium bone joints, that is known as sacroiliac joint. So when the occiput lies over the right sacroiliac joint, that is known as right occipito posterior position. And traditionally, this is also known as third position of the vertex. So traditionally, this is also known as third position of vertex. So the next term, this is sacrum, this is symphysis pubis. This is occiput and this is sinciput. So this is left sacroiliac joint. So when the occiput lies over the left sacroiliac joint, that position is known as left occipito posterior position, and traditionally this position is also known as fourth position of vertex. Next is the last one. This is sacrum, symphysis pubis. So here, so this is occiput, this is sinciput. So when the occiput directly lies over the sacrum, that position is known as direct occipito-posterior position. So these three terms or positions are maybe primary or secondary, primary means this position may be, these positions may be developed before the onset of labor. And in the case of secondary, these positions may develop after the onset of labor. Next is incidence. So in the vertex presentation, there is a 10% chances of occipito-posterior position. So next point is, the right occipito-posterior is 5 times more common as compared to the left occipito-posterior position. So right occipito-posterior position is more common position as compared to the left occipito-posterior. There are two reasons for that. First one is dextrorotation. Means rotation of the uterus. So this condition is rarely seen in the gravid state or in the pregnancy. This situation is rarely occurs. And next one is presence of sigmoid colon at the left side. So if the sigmoid So it is present at the left side. So it disfavors the left occipito-posterior position and favors to the right occipito-posterior position. Next is causes. So causes is divided under three headings. So first one is shape of pelvis. And next one is fetal factor. And next one is uterine factor. So under the shape of the pelvis, as we know that there are four types of pelvis: gynecoid, anthropoid, android, and platyploid. So gynecoid is a normal pelvis shape. So the shape of pelvis which favors the occipito-posterior position is android and anthropoid. So this is android is a heart-shaped pelvis, and means its brim, the pelvic brim is of heart shape, and in case of anthropoid, the pelvic brim is look like this. It means the transverse diameter is less, while the anterior posterior diameter is more. So these both types favor the occipito-posterior position because anteriorly they are narrow. So it favors the occipito-posterior position. So next is fetal factor. So there are certain causes which leads to deflection and which in result favors the occipito-posterior position. So the certain causes, that is the high pelvic inclination, and the placenta is attached to the anterior wall of the uterus. Next is brachycephaly. So first one is high inclination of pelvis. So high inclination of pelvis means the angle which is formed between the horizontal plate, this is horizontal plate, and the line between the PSIS and ASIS. ASIS means anteriorly superior iliac spine, and this is posteriorly superior iliac spine. So the formation of angle between the A and B, that is known as pelvis inclination, which is normally 50 to 60 degree in the females. Like here in the diagram you can see, this is a iliac crest and this is anterior superior iliac spine, and here is a posterior superior iliac spine, that is PSIS and ASIS. So the angle formed between this and the horizontal plane, that is known as pelvic inclination, and when it is more than normal, that is 50 to 60 degree, it favors the occipito posterior position. So the next under the fetal factor is placenta is attached with the interior wall of the uterus. So it is believed that the baby is always facing towards the placenta. So when the placenta is attached to the interior wall of the uterus, then the baby faces towards the placenta, which means occiput lies posteriorly. So if the placenta is attached with the interior wall of the uterus, then it favors the occipito posterior position. So next one is brachycephaly, means the head of the fetus is smaller than the normal. So if the head of the fetus is smaller than the normal, then the length from the frontal to the atlanto-occipital joint is decreases. So here the question arises, what is atlanto-occipital joint? It is also known as cranium, vertebral joint. So this joint is basically helps in the flexion and extension. So due to the brachycephaly, there is a decrease in the from the frontal to the atlanto-occipital joint. Atlanto-occipital joint is made up of the cranium bones, means the bone of the head, bones of the head. So the bones of the cranium and the vertebral column, which helps in the flexion and extension. So due to the decrease in this length, due to the brachycephaly, it leads to the decrease or diminishes the flexion. As a result, it causes deflection, so which in results favor the occipito posterior position. So next one is uterine factor. When there is an abnormal uterine contraction, it favors the occipito posterior position. So that's all about the causes of the occipito posterior position. Next is diagnosis. Under diagnosis, first one is inspection. So in the normal position, that is occipito interior position, the abdomen below the umbilicus looks round as the occiput lies anteriorly. While in the case of occipito posterior position, the abdomen below the umbilicus looks flat as the occiput lies posteriorly and the face is lies towards anteriorly, so the abdomen looks flat. So here I write, abdomen looks flat below the umbilicus. So under diagnosis, next one is umbilical grip. So these are abdominal grips. These are also known as Leopold maneuver. So here you can see in the diagram, this is an umbilical grip. This is also known as lateral grip or the second Leopold's maneuver. Here the both hands are placed over the abdomen laterally, so that we can find out that in which position the fetus back is situated or in which side the fetal limbs are placed or situated. So this umbilical grip is basically used to assess that in which side the fetal limbs or the fetal back is situated or placed. We can find out that the fetus is lying in the occipito posterior position. So with the help of umbilical grip, we can find out that the fetal limbs are feel near the middle line. or the midline. For example, this is a midline. So fetal limbs are felt near the midline. For example, in the left occipito-posterior position, when the occiput lies over the left sacroiliac joint, then the fetal limbs feel at the right side near the midline. While in the case of right occipito-posterior position, the fetal limbs feels at the left side. Next is the back of the fetus. So back of the fetus is felt far away from the midline. On the flank, flank means on the sides, like in the left side or in the left occipito-posterior position, the fetal back is lie at the left side, and in the right occipito-posterior position, fetal's back is lie at the right side, so it is far away from the midline. Next is anterior shoulder. Anterior shoulder is also lies far away from the midline. So these signs show that this is an occipito-posterior position. So here I write, limbs feels near the midline. Back of the fetus felt far away from the midline. On the over the flank or on the flank. Next is anterior shoulder lies far away from the midline. These signs shows that the fetus lie in the occipito-posterior position. This is a pelvic grip. This is also known as fourth maneuver or the fourth Leopold's maneuver in the pelvic grip. The examiner should stand like this that he or she faces the feet of the woman. So the examiner should place both the hands over the abdomen below the umbilicus. So in order to check that the head of the baby is well flexed or deflexed, in the well flexed head, the sinciput is clearly felt by the examiner. Means in the case of occipito anterior position, which is a normal position, the sinciput of the fetal head is clearly felt by the examiner or it is clearly prominent. But in the case of occipito posterior position, sinciput does not feel by the examiner. So here I write, sinciput is not felt as the fetal head is deflexed. So the sinciput is usually felt in the cases of occipito anterior position. So next is head is not engaged. Next is auscultation. So in the auscultation, fetal heart sound is heard on the flank, means on the lateral sides. While in the case of left occipito posterior position, it is difficult to hear the fetal heart sound. While in the case of direct occipito posterior position, when the occiput of the fetus lies over the sacrum, so in that position, fetal heart sound heard at the midline. Next is vaginal examination under the heading diagnosis. So in the normal position, that is occipito anterior position, when the occiput is lies interiorly, at that time during the pervaginal examination, the posterior fontanel is felt easily. But in the case of occipito posterior position, when the occiput lies posteriorly, the anterior fontanel, which is lie behind the symphysis pubis, is felt easily with the pervaginal examination. On the other hand side, the posterior fontanel is felt near the sacroiliac joint. So here I write, bag of membranes rupture during the pervaginal examination and the posterior fontanel is felt near the sacroiliac joint, while the anterior fontanel is felt easily in the case of occipito posterior position. And the last one is ultrasonography. which is also helpful in diagnosis of the occipito-posterior position. So that's all about the diagnosis of occipito-posterior position. Next is mechanism of labor. So under the mechanism of labor, the first step is engagement. So the diameter of engagement is oblique diameter. And the engaging diameter is suboccipito frontal, that is 11.5 centimeter, or occipito frontal, that is 10 centimeter. So engagement, when the head enters into the pelvic brim, that is engagement. So under this we will study two conditions. First one is favorable, and second one is non-favorable. So under favorable, here I draw a diagram. This is a pelvic brim and this is a fetal head. So in the pelvic brim, this is a sacrum, this is a symphysis pubis, so this is a sacroiliac joint, that is right, and this is a left sacroiliac joint. This is a occiput, this is a sinciput. So as we know that this pelvic brim is divided into 8 parts. So this is a iliopubic eminence. So this pelvic brim is divided into 8 parts. So in the case of favorable condition, as after the engagement, next step is flexion. So after flexion, there is an internal rotation of head. So in this favorable condition, the occiput rotates 1, 2, and 3. 3/8 of the circle and comes behind the symphysis pubis. So here I write, head rotates 3/8 of the circle and comes behind the, that is occiput comes behind the symphysis pubis. Then it causes a torsion in the neck. So next, the shoulders is also move 2/8 of the circle. So here is the shoulders. Because the 3/8 of the circle, it causes huge torsion in the neck. So to overcome that huge torsion, the shoulder also rotate 2/8 of the circle, and shoulders lie at here. So occiput lies behind the symphysis pubis, while shoulders lie at the iliopubic eminence. So here I draw a diagram. So after rotation, internal rotation, head, this is an occiput. Occiput comes behind the symphysis pubis, and the shoulders, after rotating 2/8 of the circle, comes in oblique diameter. To the internal rotation of the head, next point is, so here I write, internal rotation of head. So after the internal rotation of head, the next one is crowning. When the biparietal diameter stretches the vulval outlet. So after crowning, then there is an extension. Means here the baby's head is born, same as that in the case of occipito anterior position. So after the extension, then there is a restitution. Means here the torsion is relieved. Head bone. So in this, when the head is born, after that there is a restitution, means the torsion of neck is relieved. Like how after the head is born, then the head moves opposite to the internal rotation of the head, like this. So the head moves back by 1/8 of the circle in which the shoulders is lying, like this, like here in this diagram. As here is the occiput. So after the birth of the head, the head moves back by 1/8 of the circle in the same position as that of the shoulders. And after that, there is a internal rotation of the shoulders and external rotation of the head. And with the same normal procedure, the baby is born with the lateral flexion. So here the difference is, that is the head rotates 3/8 of the circle. This is also known as long anterior rotation. As the head moves 3/8 of the circle, so this is also known as long anterior rotation. So under the non-favorable, we will discuss it in three parts. First one is mild deflection, second one is moderate deflection, and third one is severe deflection. So here I draw the diagrams. This is a sacrum, this is a symphysis pubis, this is occiput, this is sinciput, this is sacroiliac joint. So in the mild deflection, non-favorable means when the pelvis is not favorable, it is other than the gynecoid pelvis, or the uterine contraction is not good. So in that case, what happens after the engagement, then there is a deflection. Instead of flexion, then there is a deflection. Engagement is also delayed. Here I write engagement delayed. And then is deflection. So in the mild deflection, after the deflection, there is a step, that is internal rotation of the head. So due to weak uterine contractions or due to abnormal uterine contractions and not favorable pelvis, the occiput only moves 1/8 of the circle. So it only moves 1/8 of the circle. So which this is the occiput, this is a sinciput. So after rotating 1/8, the fetal head comes in transverse diameter, that is its sagittal suture lies in a biospinous diameter. So due to this, it leads to the arrest. So this is also known as deep transverse arrest. So in this position, the occiput enters into the pelvic brim first. Then there is a rotation of occiput by 1/8 of the circle. So next is a moderate deflection. So this is occiput, this is a sinciput. So as I told that here, the occiput enters the pelvic brim first. But here, the occiput and the sinciput enters into the pelvic brim simultaneously, means at the same time. Normally only the occiput enters the pelvic brim first, as the occiput is the denominator. But in this case, in the case of moderate deflection, the occiput and sinciput enters the pelvic brim at the same time, simultaneously. So, due to which there is no flexion, or there is a moderate deflection which results in no rotation. No rotation because occiput and sinciput enters the pelvic brim simultaneously. So as a result, what happens? There is a oblique posterior arrest. So next, in the case of severe deflection, this is a sacrum, symphysis pubis. So this is a occiput, this is a sinciput. So this is a sacroiliac joint, right? Sacroiliac joint. So in the case of severe deflection, here the sinciput enters the pelvic brim first. As in this case, occiput and sinciput enters the pelvic brim at the same time. But in this case, sinciput enters the pelvic brim first. So here I write sinciput enters the pelvic brim first. So after the engagement, in the case of severe deflection, the sinciput rotates by 1/8 of the circle and the sinciput lies behind the symphysis pubis. So after the rotation of sinciput by 1/8 of the circle, so here is a diagram. The sinciput is behind the symphysis pubis and the fetal skull comes in an anterior posterior diameter. So in severe deflection, there is a two possibilities. If there is a good uterine contractions plus favorable pelvis, then there is a chances of spontaneous delivery. That is phase 2 pubis delivery. Otherwise, in the second possibility, if there is a no uterine good uterine contractions and the pelvis is also not favorable, that is, it is other than gynecoid pelvis, so in that case, arrest occurs. So this position is also known as occipito sacral position. So in that case, the arrest will be known as occipito sacral arrest. So that's all about the mechanism of labor. At last, there is a management of occipito posterior position. So first of all, early diagnosis. We should have to diagnose it earlier that the fetus lies in occipito posterior position, which is an abnormal position. Next is carefully monitor the labor. Carefully monitor the progress of labor. Next is judicious and timely interference. Judicious means with the good judgment, there should be a timely treatment. Means treatment should be given at proper time, as early as possible. So under this, there is a two condition. First one is early cesarean section. So in the case of occipito posterior position, if there is complications plus there is inadequate pelvis, in that case immediate cesarean section should be done. While on the other case, there is a watchful expectancy. Watchful expectancy means watch for the spontaneous delivery. So here, oxytocin should be administered to increase the uterine contraction, as oxytocin is basically administered to for the uterine contractions. Next is carefully monitor at the early second stage of labor. So under this, again, there is a two conditions. First one is favorable condition and unfavorable. So under the favorable, long anterior rotation. Long anterior rotation, when the occiput rotates by 3/8 of the circle. So in the occiput posterior position, there is a 90% chances that the occiput rotates 3/8 of the circle. So in that case, there is a chances of spontaneous delivery. Means the normal delivery with the minimal aid or the with the minimum help. So, but there may be the need for the use of ventose or the forceps for the delivery in certain cases. Means in this case, there is a good chances of spontaneous delivery, but if any complication arise, we can use the ventose and forceps for the delivery. On the other hand side, in the cases of unfavorable condition, under this, there is a mild deflection. In the mild deflection, there is a partial anterior rotation, as the head rotates 1/8 of the circle. So due to which it causes deep transverse arrest. And the second is moderate deflection. In this case, the occiput does not rotate, so here is non-rotation. And in the third case, so it leads to oblique posterior arrest. So in the last case, there is a severe deflection. So in this, the sinciput rotates by 1/8 of the circle and comes behind the symphysis pubis. So this is mal rotation, means abnormal rotation. So this position is known as occipito sacral position. So in this, first of all, we will discuss the severe deflection. So there is a two chances in the occipito sacral position. If the pelvis is adequate, if there is a good amount of uterine contractions, then there is a chances of spontaneous delivery. On the other hand side, if there is inadequate pelvis, if there is no good uterine contraction, if there is complications at that point, so it causes arrest. That is occipito sacral arrest. So in that case, there is again two possibilities. So one is, we should have to note the station. Note the station of head. So if the head is above the ischial spines, then in that case, cesarean section should be done. But if the head lies below the ischial spines, in that case, delivery should be done with the help of forceps or ventos with deep episiotomy. Episiotomy is a surgical procedure in which the cut is made on the perineum so that head can be easily delivered. And next, in the cases of partial anterior rotation or non-rotation, there will be an assisted delivery. So here is a three conditions. In this case, there is a three conditions. If the pelvis is inadequate, then what should be done? Cesarean section. But if the pelvis is favorable, In that case, assisted delivery should be done with the use. There will be a manual rotation or forceps rotation, and the delivery should only be done by the expert. So in these cases, in the partial anterior rotation, in the non-rotation, if the pelvis is adequate, then the head of the fetus is rotated with the help of hand, that is known as manual rotation. Or if the head is rotated with the help of forceps, then it is known as forceps rotation. And next, there is a third possibility. If the fetus is dead, so in that case, craniotomy should be done. Craniotomy is, this is a surgical procedure to remove the bulk from the head so that it can be easily delivered from the vagina. So that's all about the management of occipito and posterior position. So I hope you all are cleared with the occipito posterior position. So if you have any kind of query, please ask me in the comment section, and you can also suggest me the topics for the further videos. So at last, stay safe, stay at home. Good luck to all. Thank you.